that's paid off, and that leaves the checking account with about, $1,377. Like I said, if anybody wants to see the numbers, I have them right here, what our income and expenses are. But the good news is, through all your generosity, we still got money in the checking account. And are there any questions that I can answer? Just, you know, anything off the top of your head? Okay, could I have, could I hear a motion to accept the treasurer's report?
I'm making
Tom,
a motion.
Tom Campione, do I hear a second?
Awesome.
Mary Ellen? Everybody in favor, could you raise your hand?
Aye.
Anybody objections? Thank you.
Brian Eichfeld.
Yes.
Finance and Fundraising Committee. Come on up. If you noticed tonight, Jake wasn't handing out agendas. In the email that we sent out announcing the meeting, we included the agenda. We're trying to save money and cut costs everywhere we can. So rather than print out 100 sheets of paper and then throw them away after the meeting, if you're interested in a copy of the agenda, it'll be in your email. If you have a smartphone, you can pull it up at the meeting and not have to print out any paper. Unless your phone crashes and you need a piece of paper.
Just make sure it's on silent. Just make sure it's on silent.
Okay. Did you, do you have the on the video?
This
no.
is finance report. This is not announcements.
A finance report. Okay, I'm not prepared for finance report. Wing it. We need money. we're having a meeting. I'm going to be setting up a meeting in 2 weeks for the pig roast. That's our main event coming up for fundraising. So we're asking folks to sign up. It's a great time and it's a great way for us to make some money. So and also at the next meeting, if you can bring some more donations for raffles and stuff like that for the event, that would be great also. So that's what we're asking for right now, and we will put together more detail in the future when if I know I had a presentation to give. I guess I should read my emails. Well, we're going to talk about the upcoming events later, or do you want me to do it now?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
And Brian will be back. Good evening, everyone. I pray that everyone is well. Just the fact that we're here tonight says something, because the fact that we have the freedom and the health to be able to attend a meeting like tonight says something about our liberties and our country. Because I just finished reading a book about with Corrie Ten Boom about the tragedies that we had in Germany years ago. And I mean, we have so many liberties here, so amen. Everyone I know is currently going through a really, really hard time. So I spoke to my girlfriend today, and she's telling me she had 9 inches of water in her basement recently. And then it rained, and then she had 3 feet of water in her basement. And I couldn't comprehend what that's like. She says, well, it's not too bad because my neighbor has 9 feet in his basement. So everybody has problems and everybody is going through something. But so there I was today in our storage shed, packing some boxes for the troops, because that's what we have. We have a wonderful storage shed that is supported solely by Helitown Sportsman Association. They pay our annual rent. And so I'm like, what am I going to talk about tonight? I always bring a letter from our soldiers, and I look up and it says, I had this posted for lack of place to put it, and it said, real joy comes not from the ease or riches, but from the praises of men. No, let me read that again. Real joy comes not from eases or riches, or from the praises of men, but from doing something worthwhile. And that made me feel good, because I know we are all doing something worthwhile, A, by being here, B, by you people supporting us, Blair and I, with the support of the troops. And those of you who don't know us, we are here every month, and you bring your magazines, your toothbrushes, currently looking for sunscreen and microwavable popcorn. Those little things all come together, and they help. And it works. So thank you. And what can you do is you can write a note. Say thank you for our service. We always have stationery in the back because, again, in every package is magazines, hygienes, snacks, letters of support, a U.S. Constitution, a little mini flag, and letters of support. And those letters, this is what they mean. I can't stand this. Hello, Valerie and Blair. I wanted to write and say thank you for your card and the packages and the notes from everyone. It's wonderful to know that there is support for the troops at home, and it's always good for me and the other troops to know that we have support at home. Thank you for understanding that I don't need as many goodies as other people do. But the love and the support and the notes are great to get. Thank you for doing so much for our military. Thank you for making sure they know that we are loved. It means a lot to us. I wanted to say thank you for all the time and the money you devote. Thank you. God bless. Heather. So don't forget, we're always looking for notes. You can always give us your soldiers' names, your neighbors, friends, soldiers' names. You are our network. We're always looking for names. I thank you. I ask God to bless all of you, all of your families, our soldiers, and America.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Tony Simeo. I am the secretary of the Lehigh Valley Tea Party. And as always, I email the minutes out to Mr. Tom Campione, who then posts them on the website for all of your enjoyment and review. At this moment, I would like to get a motion to accept the minutes as they have been presented online. Mr. Kate Phillips. Don't make me drag it out of you people. Seconded by Mr. Bob Kernicki. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Thank you.
Will you all please join me?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Tony. Happy birthday to you.
He doesn't like surprises.
Thank you.
Hi. I'm Jay Spada on the Energy and Environment Committee. We're sponsoring the guest speaker tonight. He is Kevin Keller. Here. Kevin has extensive experience in the energy and utilities industry and currently is Director of Midstream Business Development for UGI. In addition to that, as part of that, he is working on the Penn East Pipeline, which he's going to tell you about. He'll discuss the project, its benefits, costs, impacts, mitigations, etc. What I'd ask is, because of time, save your questions to the end. And Kevin will be happy to answer as many of them as we have time for. Kevin, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, happy Friday evening.
I'm here to talk about Penn East Pipeline. As Jay mentioned, my name is Kevin Kelleher. The Pennies Pipeline is a really unique project. It's a project that is going to be impacting this area, this region. And so obviously we'd love to make sure that the communities are aware of why we're building it, the potential impacts of the project, and also, again, who's building it. I think these are really critical things that people want to know about the pipeline project. So I'm going to give you guys a real brief overview of the project. And as Jay mentioned, I'd love to answer questions that you may have regarding it. First things first, so PennEast. PennEast is actually a partnership of six major energy distributors that cover Pennsylvania and New Jersey. And we'll get a little bit into ultimately why we came together, but I want to make it clear that UGI, representing, again, markets here in Pennsylvania, and basically every utility in New Jersey are partners in this pipeline project, okay? This is the overall route, and we'll talk in a little bit more detail about how that route was developed, but ultimately, the design of the project is somewhat simple. There is a low-cost, abundant domestic resource in northeastern Pennsylvania, currently the most economic play in the country, that we want to make sure that all of Pennsylvania markets and the New Jersey markets have access to, okay? So generally speaking, that's the route, but we'll talk a little bit in more detail about how we develop sort of some of the nuances to this route. So as I mentioned, this is a project. Ultimately, the way these projects are developed is we have folks who contract for the space in the pipeline. And again, the folks who are contracting for that space are the utilities that serve the consumers in this region. There's been a lot of talk, I'm sure you folks may have seen, if you're familiar with the project at all, that there's a lot of discussion about us exporting gas. That is not the case. I can tell you unequivocally, this is not an export project. So just some technical details about the pipeline project. This is 114 miles. In the scheme of things and in the scheme of pipelines across this country, this is a relatively short distance pipeline. It's a 36-inch diameter pipeline, and it's roughly about $1 billion investment. It's closer to $1.2 billion. And really, the reason that we're building this project is because of the potential for consumer savings that it brings. We're talking about the lowest cost resource of natural gas in the country. But here in lower southeastern Pennsylvania and in New Jersey, we still pay some of the highest prices of power and natural gas in the country. The project itself is also going to have an economic boon during its construction. We're talking about employing up to 2,600 people during the design and construction aspects of this project over a 3-year period or so. So that has a significant impact to the region because we have a lot of folks in here working on the project helping to develop and construct it. As we talked about, this is access to the Marcellus, right? And this is accessing, creating that direct connection between that local resource and the local markets. Now, just to put things in perspective, what is a BCF a day? The pipeline is capable of moving 1 billion cubic feet of gas a day. That's the equivalent of being able to heat 4.7 million homes, okay? Now, we're not necessarily looking to heat 4.7 million homes. Some of this is gonna go to other markets, like industry, manufacturing. Power generation is a significant load. But just to give you sort of a size and scale of what 1 billion cubic feet means. And again, we'll talk a little bit about the process. This is a FERC project, and that's a Federal Energy Regulatory Commission project. They have jurisdiction over us. But as part of that process, we have to actually go out and show that there's a need for this project. So we hold what's called an open season. That open season basically is available for utilities, power generators, marketers, basically to come and say, hey, we want participation in that project because we see a need. And our project was basically almost fully subscribed when we went out for that open season. Okay. And as I mentioned, I represent UGI. I'm here again talking on behalf of PennEast because UGI is the project manager. We're going to be the constructor and the operator of the project. And some of the additional benefits is, and some of these benefits you'll see here in Lehigh Valley. There's obviously a lot of benefits that they'll see in New Jersey, but when you have a new pipeline and that pipeline is going to hit different parts of utility systems, that provides additional system reliability for those utility systems. It introduces sources of supply in areas where they may not have had it before. You have, again, economic development when you're putting an asset in place like a pipeline, typically in areas where there wasn't one before, well, things tend to pop up around it. Whether it be industry or residences or commercial opportunities. And again, we're talking about expanding the use of a clean, abundant, and domestic resource. So These are, again, the reasons why we build these projects. Again, we have the sort of the temporary, or what I'll call sort of the initial benefits, which is an economic benefit. We're talking about introducing $1.2 billion into the economy. Now, some of that, you know, is spread out across the country, but a lot of it is actually focused here in the region, in Pennsylvania and in New Jersey. So based on that, we've done what we call an economic model or an economic output model, or we've had some consultants do this. And what basically what they came up with is the dollars that we anticipate spending in this region are going to end up generating $1.6 billion in economic impact, economic activity. It's going to support 12,000 jobs. It's going to also provide $740 million in wages to this region. That's the initial benefit from just constructing and designing. But then the ongoing benefit, again, is this connection to the low-cost resource, the consumer savings. And I'm not talking about just natural gas. This is actually also, there is a more significant savings potential from reducing electric costs, because so much power is now generated utilizing natural gas. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But not to get into a whole lot of detail and not to bore you folks on commodity pricing and the natural gas market, but to look at this simply, the stuff in orange, that's bad. That's when gas prices are really high and it costs folks a lot of money to heat their homes and to generate power. The yellow and the purple, that's where the cost of the gas is up in northeastern Pennsylvania. Okay? So what you're seeing here is this is what we call a basis differential. So this is relative to like sort of what we call a national index price, the Henry Hub, which is a Gulf price. What we see is that here in New Jersey and southeastern Pennsylvania, when it gets cold or there's a lot of load on the system, the cost of gas goes up because there's limited infrastructure. But where the gas is being produced, just 100 miles away, it's even less than Gulf gas. Okay? And Gulf gas is traditionally where this market area was supplied. So when folks say, well, prices are set nationally, there is no benefit to doing this, I question that, because this is what happens. This is what happens when you don't have enough infrastructure, is you have a lot of gas that's cheap, stuck up in northeastern Pennsylvania, yet folks in southeastern Pennsylvania, New Jersey, are paying a lot of for their gas, okay? So this is a highlight from two winters ago. This past winter, you had a similar reaction. It wasn't as peaky, we didn't have the polar vortex this past winter, but again, you had significant days where there were significant price increases in this local region. Yet the price of gas 100 miles away was the cheapest natural gas in the country. So what does it take to build one of these projects? Again, we're following a federally regulated process here. It takes us, according to this schedule here, generally speaking, it's almost a three-year development timeline between permitting, again, attracting the market, permitting, designing, engineering. It takes us 7 months to build it, okay? So I just, it's important for me to put that in perspective, because folks think that this project is gonna have these long-term, long drawn out impacts when we present schedules like this. The actual construction process is a 7 month process. The rest of it is trying to get the project approved, okay? So where we are in this process, we're sort of under this, again, this 2015 timeframe. We're in what's called a pre-filing process, which is a voluntary process. We're basically showing all of our cards in this timeframe. We're showing all of the potential impacts from an environmental perspective, from a cultural perspective, from an economic perspective. We're presenting that to FERC in a voluntary method and saying, here are all the things that we see along the path. Here are all the reasons why we're building it. Here are all the potential issues from us constructing it. And we present that to them in various reports. Well, that process then moves into a more formal setting where we make a final application, but the FERC has now seen all of the potential issues up front, okay? This is also an opportunity where we allow the public to comment, to participate, and share their concerns. And obviously there are a wide-ranging, number of concerns about it. But then ultimately FERC will make its decision, and we're expecting that decision to come sometime late 2016. So I just provide you a brief overview of this slide here. So I won't go through a whole lot of detail here, but again, in terms of the things that we have to provide to FERC to showcase the things that we're looking at, the impacts, these are all the different, and in each one of these reports, I'm not kidding, each one of these reports is at least probably 80 to 100 pages, okay? So every one of these resources, we're paying specific attention to threatened endangered species, wetland and water bodies, socioeconomic impacts, housing impacts, all the various things, all the geologic issues. In this particular area, karst is a concern, sinkholes are a concern. So we have to basically lay out for FERC what those issues are, how we're going to either minimize, avoid, or mitigate those impacts. And so we're looking through a whole host of issues. So again, if there's a notion that when we build a pipeline, what we do is we knock a bunch of trees down, we shove it in the ground, and we take off, it's not true. We have to do so much analysis into what that project means, what it does to the environment, how we have to make sure the environment gets back to the way it was once we're complete. This is a very thorough process, and we're okay with that process. It is a process that we're comfortable with. We understand that when we've developed assets in these neighborhoods, in these communities, that we've got to put them back to the way they were before we got there. So these slides basically are just more detailed maps, but again, generally speaking, I don't know if there's a pointer on here, but so most of the gas, most of the higher quality or the higher volume wells that we're talking about in Pennsylvania, the more economic wells, are where these, what we call gathering lines are, situated throughout northeastern Pennsylvania, Susquehanna, Bradford, Wyoming County. That's where the heart of the Marcellus is, and that's where we're sourcing most of our gas from, is from gathering lines like this. And then ultimately what we're delivering, or what we're doing, is we're delivering that gas to UGI here in the Lehigh Valley. There are interstate pipelines that then go into New Jersey, and that's what you're seeing, some of these other interconnects. Elizabethtown Gas, that's another utility in New Jersey. And then these other interconnects are, again, our distribution or interstate pipes that take it to further markets in New Jersey. And there's also a utility in New York that is subscribing this project. Yeah?
Could you go back?
Sure.
All those other lines, are those already existing pipelines?
When you say other lines, I just want to make sure. So,
like the pink line.
This is an existing line. This is an existing line. That's an existing line, and that's an existing line.
Not that dark red.
The dark red one is the one we're constructing.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Just to give you a real brief overview of what construction looks like. So again, prior to construction, not only are we getting FERC approval, but we're getting state and local approvals as well. State, again, we're consulting with various agencies throughout the state. The State Department of Environmental Protection. The Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, the Fish and Boat Commission, the Pennsylvania Game Commission, Pennsylvania Historical Museum Commission. We consult with all of these agencies in addition to the federal agencies, and we also do the same in New Jersey, and we get their approval and permits. And once we begin construction, the construction of a pipeline is very much like a manufacturing line. We have a process where you start at one end. You begin sort of your initial preparation methods, which is clearing and grading the construction work area. You're then moving through with another set of crew that's actually coming in, stringing the pipe and laying the pipe along the rights of way. Then you have another crew behind them that's welding the pipe, another crew behind them that's excavating a trench, another crew behind them that's dropping it into the trench, another crew that's backfilling. And so it's this process, or this assembly line, that continues to move along. So when I talk about 7 months, the actual time that we spend on an individual property is very short. We're there in spurts, a crew doing this, a crew doing that, a crew doing that. But the overall length of the 114 miles, that's what we're talking, is going to take 7 months. But the actual impact to a specific property or an area is a very short time framed event. Okay? Safety. Safety is obviously a significant concern. I can tell you that these pipelines today are built to the state of the art. Okay, so we're talking about, we start from basically evaluating the material itself. We have material reports and inspections done on the material, the pipeline material itself, before we even purchase it, we're inspecting it. Before it's even delivered to us, we're inspecting it. That pipeline is designed to certain federal conditions that we exceed. Before we put that pipeline into service, we're testing all of our welders to ensure that they can weld the facilities that we're talking about. We have inspectors that are watching them as they weld. We x-ray 100% of the welds. We then place that pipeline under significant pressure test, well in excess, at least 150% of what we ever plan on operating that pipeline at before we even put any gas into that pipe. We put a special coating around the pipe to ensure that there's no corrosion on the pipe. We actually test that corrosion before we put the pipe into service. And throughout this entire process, we have the FERC inspecting us, We have third-party environmental inspectors that we hire to inspect our crews, and we also have the state and local authorities, again, inspecting us. So, again, when I talk about safety, safety is all there is to us, right? There is this project and the economic benefits and everything we do means nothing if this pipeline doesn't operate safely. So safety is obviously a core to us. And then most importantly, you know, when it comes to local communities, we work with the local emergency response officials. We train, we drill. We actually, some of you who may actually participate in some of the local emergency response agencies here, we're actually providing grants before we've even gotten our certificate. We're providing grants to local communities, to the local fire departments, to go get equipment to be prepared to respond if there was an emergency along our facility. So restoration, again, I already mentioned quickly what restoration, again, we're focused on making sure that we put these communities back to the way we found them. But again, I'll highlight the fact that we have specific permit conditions that are regulated by the FERC, by the state agencies that make sure that what we're putting back and what we're restoring have to meet those conditions, okay? But you know, some folks, they're not really sure what we mean when we're putting a pipeline in, what restoration looks like, so I just brought a couple of examples. So some folks will suggest, hey, in a farm field, what can I do? Well, you can do whatever it is you did before we put that pipeline in. The top left picture is what we look like when we were constructing or initially clearing. And about a year and a half later, that's the farm field again, okay? Now, when we clear trees, trees will actually continue to remain clear, all right? So we do have impacts, and I would not suggest that there aren't any impacts, but we minimize our impacts to every extent possible, okay? Here's another example. Here's where we cross what they called an exceptional value stream. So this stream had wild trout. So there was a lot of sensitivity to how we crossed this stream. So what we did, in a very brief discussion here, but when we crossed this stream, we crossed in what we called the dry. We actually put bladder dams on both the upstream and the downstream side. We then designed pumps to actually pump around those dams at the same flow of the natural flow of the stream. We put screens on both the inlet and the outlet to ensure that we weren't sucking up any aquatic life. We ensured that when it went back into the downstream side that there wasn't a whole lot of turbidity. And this is what the stream looked like after we were done. This was after 24 hours, and I kid you not, this was 24 hours. We actually improved the bank system on this stream. As you can see on the other side, we put a bunch of riprap in. Prior to that, this stream had more sedimentation and erosion going into it than what it looks like afterwards, okay? So this is our community too. We have lots of folks that live and work in this community. We have lots of folks that recreate in this community. We're not here to destroy the community, right? We're here to build a project that brings a lot of benefits and minimize our impacts. And again, I'm sensitive to the fact that there are a lot of folks, there's a lot of discussion about the project, but I just also want to point out that you know, there's a lot of hearsay about what this project is and what it will do and what it really benefits. But there are a lot of folks that understand, again, what this means. And I hope, again, tonight goes a short way of making you folks understand why we build these projects and why it's so important for this region. But this is just to highlight some of the other folks that recognize, again, the benefits of infrastructure, and in particular, the Pennies Pipeline Project. And if you have any questions, we do have a website. We have a Facebook page. We have a Twitter feed. I'm not a huge social network guy, but feel free to visit our site. We have all sorts of material on there as well for you guys to peruse. But again, we would ask, obviously, to the extent that you guys are willing, we're always looking for support. You can contact your local legislators, and we have ways to access forms and easily to do that. The FERC is also looking to hear from you folks, so there are ways for you to submit comments to FERC, whether you have a question about the project or whether you're in support of the project. Again, we want to make sure that you folks are educated and are participating in the process. Any questions?
Yeah, I'm going to drive to work.
Before questions start being asked, if you don't have a microphone, please don't ask a question. Wait until one of us comes to you.
Yeah, on my drive to work, I see anti-pipeline signs. How are you going to deal with the opposition, and how strong is the opposition to this project?
So the way we deal with opposition is, again, we know why we're building the project. There are, as I'm sure you can imagine, we play by a different rule. We have to be upfront and transparent about what the project is, the impacts that it has. That's why we go through this pre-filing process with FERC. But again, what we believe and what we think is ultimately why we believe that FERC would ultimately approve this project is because the significant benefits that this project provides significantly outweigh the impacts that we're already focused on minimizing. So there's obviously a lot of opposition that will suggest other things, but you know, again, what we provide is data. What we provide is reality. What we provide is historically what we've done. I can tell you this, I've been asked this question a lot and doing a lot of presentations about, well, there's such an overwhelming opposition. It's a very vocal opposition, but if I were to couch it sort of in this way, if these utilities that are signing up for these projects, they serve anywhere from 2.5 million gas consumers to 5 million electric consumers. If I were to go to all those consumers and say, hey, I can lower your gas and your electric bills, I'm going to build a 100-mile pipeline project, have a 50-foot corridor that I'm going to build that in, I'm going to site that in as minimally impactful way as I can, I'm going to construct it and then restore that to the best of my ability to the condition it was before I got there, I'm going to compensate the landowners that are impacted by that, and I'm going to bring these significant savings to you as well as to the local communities, I'm going to provide an economic boom while I'm constructing it. How many of those 2.5 million or 5 million electric and gas consumers do you think would support the project? I think a lot of them would, but they're just not vocal. So we end up having to be the voice for those folks. Okay, and yes, the opposition is vocal and they're loud and they're in the paper. But again, we have, I think, the truth on our side. Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, as deal with the stream crossings. Mm-hmm. In your impact study, do you identify all? Do they impact or identify every stream that they're going to cross?
Every stream.
Okay.
And well, we identify every stream. We even identify streams that have no water in them.
Yes.
Yeah.
And every stream that has trout, are they identified?
Absolutely.
And how do you deal with the trout when they spawn if you have the porta dams and the connecting pipe?
Yeah, so typically there are windows with which we can construct in streams.
Right.
There are other potential conditions that the permitting agencies put on us that say if, and again, this is usually stream specific, but there may be a different crossing method we have to employ to cross that stream. We may have to not, build a dam on either side and cross it in the dry. We may have to bore the stream or do a drill underneath the stream to ensure that we're not affecting anything within the stream. So. There are a number of things, and again, the agencies are all over us, and they're making sure that and we're aware of those windows where the trout spawn. And so, typically, there is usually restrictions, but in addition to that, they might also affect how we construct across it.
Let me say that I live in Moore Township, and first of all, the pipeline is coming within maybe 2 football fields of our house. And I have no concern whatsoever about safety because I'm in the piping business. I know that there's no issues there. My concern is two things. Mm-hmm. Number one is we live in the woods. So I want to know how big a swath you're going to eliminate the woods. Number two is we don't have any UGI service in Moore Township.
Mm-hmm.
I am paying through the roof for oil. So why can't UGI give us some natural gas up there? I'd take that in a heartbeat. Half my heating bill, it would be half my heating bill.
Yeah. So your first question about the swath that we build through a forested area. So our typical construction width, because we have not only, we have a 50-foot permanent width, and that's the 50 feet that we permanently keep clear and maintain. But during construction, we'll actually clear typically roughly another 40 to 50 feet, 90 to 100 feet total. We typically try as best we can to site these near what we call existing utilities or co-locate, but there are some areas where we just can't. So it would be initially a 100-foot clearing. We would allow 40 to 50 feet to grow back to its natural vegetative state, but the 50-foot is what we would permanently keep clear. Your next question about the extension of distribution systems, So I could probably keep you here all night on what it would take to do that. But the quickest way for me to respond to that is the utility model and developing utility distribution systems is one that's highly regulated. The Public Utility Commission pays a very close attention to the local utility on how they invest those dollars and how they recover those dollars from consumers. So it's often a case about, you know, in order for me to build into an area, there needs to be, you know, and I have to install a significant amount of facilities to build that piping, to build the regulator station, to build it off of a Penny Spike project. That costs a significant amount of money that a single landowner can't bear. Right, so you need density, you need quantity of folks. And obviously, if you're very rural and spread out, you know, building more pipe to a further and further location, you don't get sort of those economies to make it work. Two things I'll just say on that. So that's why typically in rural areas, you don't see natural gas distribution yet. But two things that I'll just mention is, it takes time, though, to potentially extend distribution systems. If you look at what UGI utilities, utility market looks like now, that took 100 years to develop. So, and it didn't develop necessarily, you know, if you look at its systems, it develops off of a lot of these interstate pipeline systems that get built. So once the pipeline gets built, you get, you know, a large commercial project or industrial project that starts the investment. And then a residential house or a residential community develops nearby and extends it even further, and so on and so on. So it takes time for that to develop. The other thing I'll just point out is UGI is one of the only utilities, or they were one of the first utilities to develop a pilot program to actually begin to try and deploy distribution systems in rural areas in Pennsylvania. And they do that through a special rate model that they've created. But that's a pilot program. It's already like fully, there are, I can't tell you how many communities, there's a huge waiting list for that. So I hear you. I mean, and that's why we build pennies, because folks like you, there are a lot of folks that recognize the benefits of utilizing natural gas in their homes, generating power in their businesses, it makes them more competitive. So the demand in natural gas has gone up. And because a lot of folks, when they burn it for their homes, it's not like you're seeing this growth occur throughout the year. I mean, there's a little bit of growth throughout the year, but definitely in the winter times, you get these really peaky usage periods. And that's when those prices spike. But it's because of that growth that you can't just have these existing interstates serve, you know, they're static. They don't change in size. They don't grow in volume. So if you continue to grow demand and you have more power generation, more homes converting, you need some way, other way to supply that. And that's what PennEast is really designed to do.
Yeah,
sorry for the long-winded answer there.
Well, focus on more township.
Yeah, I'd prefer if you keep it a little shorter.
Sorry.
I got two quick questions. One is, if the three-year process of paperwork, how much is that adding to the cost of the project? That's a critical question, because I think the people are getting sick and tired of the EPA and all this other on top of everything. And you don't sound like you're fighting for the people, because UGI is not going to pay that $1.25 billion for cost of that pipeline. The people sitting in this room are. So if the government is adding 3 years onto the contract for BS, what does that cost us? Keep it short.
Yeah. I don't know.
I got another question.
Know. It's significant. And it's perhaps not the timing as much as it is there are a lot of things. There is definitely some wasted effort to just ensure things that we, I don't know off the top of my head, sir. I wish I could tell you. It's significant, I'm sure.
I'd like to say,
if you don't have a microphone, please don't ask questions.
I'd like to say that I think it's wonderful to see this progress of man, and I support this pipeline 100%.
Thank you.
I would like to call FERC or contact FERC and show them my support for this pipeline. If you could put that contact information back up.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think what this points to our website, but from there we have links to how you can contact FERC and others.
Okay, so the question is, actually a couple of questions here. You'd mentioned that you're trying to use existing right-of-way for...
Put the mic close to your mouth.
You mentioned that you are trying to use existing right-of-way.
Where we can.
Where you can.
Right.
Does any of that... First question, is any of it following any of what is currently the Susquehanna-Roseland project, which is the joint venture between PPL and PSE&G?
I don't believe so. I think that heads in a different direction than where we're going.
All right. The second part of it is for the pieces that you're doing, how much of that actually requires condemnation of land?
Well,
or does it?
Yeah. So we don't know yet. Obviously, there are going to be folks that we expect are probably not going to want to work with us. And again, we recognize that we're introducing ourselves into people's lives here. You know, they didn't ask us to come, and so we're sensitive to the fact that there are just going to be some folks that no matter what we're willing to compensate them or what we're willing to do to try and minimize their impacts, they may not want to work with us. And so I suspect that there will be some, but we really do try to avoid those for the most part. We were having dinner earlier and I was mentioning that typically our process is to compensate folks above market value typically, but typically we pay them more up front. I think the gentlemen were surprised that, you would think that as you go further into negotiation, as folks hold out and they're making you potentially go to the eminent domain proceedings, that you'll end up paying them more and more. And it's really opposite. We would prefer not to condemn. We would prefer to work out an arrangement where we understand that we're going to be neighbors with these folks for many, many years. So we make every effort to try and reach an amenable arrangement. Unfortunately, there may be situations where we have to do that. Thank you.
How deep in the ground does this pipeline go?
I'm sorry, say it.
What is the depth of this pipeline?
So the minimum is 36 inches, but typically, for instance, like in an ag field, we might work out with a farmer where we'll go deeper. Typically, we'll go at least 4 feet in an ag field. Certain water crossings or water body crossings will go deeper than that. Certain road crossings will go deeper than that. But the minimum is usually 36 inches.
And will the people of the state receive any kind of tax relief at all from this?
I don't think there'll be tax relief, but obviously there'll be income taxes that that Penny's partners will pay. Again, we talked a little bit about the economic impacts, not only from the construction and the economic impacts from that. And I think we estimated that produces, again, from the spending of the dollars that we're investing in the communities, that I think is, our study is on our website, but I think it was about $17 million a year in personal income taxes. But again, what we look at is when you look at the consumer savings, that $900 million a year, that's disposable income. That's dollars that then folks have more to spend in their communities doing other things. That generates additional tax revenue. So there is a significant tax benefit. But if you're talking about, there's a thing in the local paper here, is there an increase in property tax revenue? And the answer is, on something like that, no, there's not. But there are other forms of tax revenue that we generate.
It's kind of interesting because I've been following this through the papers, and a old friend of mine, I can't say good because I haven't seen him for a while, Drew Germanowski, he's a geologist at Lehigh, and he starts talking about sinkholes, and yep. I'm like, boy, that is an interesting point, but I can't imagine that they haven't been engineered into it, and it's frustrating to me when I see those things out there, and they make the claim that there's potential problems, but obviously, and that's what I wanted to say, what kind of engineering goes in to prevent any problems from a sinkhole?
Sure, so we actually do what's called a geophysics study. So we're actually taking what we call an electric resistivity imaging study, where we're basically measuring the anomalies under the ground, in particular in those karst areas. So areas that are limestone or other geologic conditions that are typical for sinkholes. And we'll actually go out and we'll determine, are there certain areas that we need to go do further investigation on? I can tell you that the pipeline itself, is a significant piece of infrastructure that we've done calculations that if there was an unsupported span of over 100 feet, the pipeline would still operate safely, okay? So you'd have to have a massive sinkhole open up underneath. But before that, we're trying to do pre-investigation with this geophysics study to identify whether there are anomalies underneath where we're going. And if there are, we'll go out and do additional studies. We'll go do a geotech boring, see, you know, what kind of a void it might be. And then if necessary, we may go fill or we may go avoid that area. And so we're doing those studies, though, to ensure that the pipeline won't be subject to certain risks. But the other thing I just have to remind folks is there are other pipelines in this region that have been operating in karstic condition for many, many years. This isn't new. Pipelines traverse this country, and there are karst areas throughout this country, and they perform very well in those areas.
That's your chance.
I'm a councilman in Northampton County. And sort of to address this gentleman's concern about people who are protesting it.
Mm-hmm.
As a legislator, we get a lot of people coming up to us and trying to sway us. And I was at a meeting the other day where it wasn't for this, it was in regards to the Columbia pipeline and the compressor statement. And I made the statement, I'll say it now. You know, I'm pro American oil independence and energy independence. I'm pro pipeline, pro compressor station. So I'm for that. There's also a lot of legislators, something alluded to is that there's not a taxing ability at the local municipal level. You know, every municipality that you pass through would like to tax them. I'm not of that mind. But going back to the gentleman's from Moore Township, what I'm interested in as a legislator is that you do have connections into metropolitan areas like Bethlehem and Hallertown, which mm-hmm. you do have,
yep.
where we could get access to that cheap energy to build production facilities that bring in jobs. And that's the tax money I'm interested
sure.
in. I'm not interested that much in taxing. I'm not interested at all in taxing the pipeline. I'm interested in the economy that's going to be built that can be mastered. Can you talk a little bit? I know we talked about residential, but I heard there's only one access point in Northampton County, and that's in the Hallertown area.
Yep.
Can you talk about that? And I would love, as a legislator, I'd love to say there's going to be more.
Sure. So I think what's important is it's not necessarily a question of the quantity of connections to PennEast. It's does Bethlehem and Allentown and Easton, do these metropolitan areas get the benefit of the low-cost gas that we're delivering, because UGI's existing utility system may be able to distribute that gas once it gets here adequately, and we don't want to build redundant facilities or unnecessary facilities. What we want to make sure is that they're getting access to the cheapest cost gas in the country, right? And so that's why we're connecting at an existing interconnect in the Hallertown area, because from there, UGI already has an extensive distribution system. They can make sure that it can expand and grow. Just as an example, and I'm sorry, just to go back to one point about the Moore Township question there is, I think it was your question, I'm sorry, about, again, while natural gas, one thing I will remind you is, again, your electric utility costs will go down from having a project like this be installed, okay?
So in the winter, we don't use electric.
Sure, but I'm just saying that there are some benefits that you'll see, even if you're not a natural gas consumer. But just as an example of what you're talking about, we would love to see that industry grow too. I mean, it's more load, it's potential for us to, you know, to deliver more volume in the area. And I can tell you that we've already heard from folks asking us, you know, they're aware of what we're building, they're aware of the economics of us accessing low-cost gas, they're aware that this is the market, this is where, you know, there's great highway systems and access in this area, and they're saying, hey, what's a good area for us to site a facility? You know, that creates jobs, that creates a tax revenue base. And so we talk about things like the Lehigh Valley, the industrial park right off of 412 there. We talk about that as, hey, we're coming right by there, you know. So that is how pipelines do draw in, and that's one of the points I make in terms of the additional benefits in addition to the consumer savings is the additional economic development that tends to build up around utility infrastructure like PennEast, because, you know, let's face it, for manufacturing loads and industrial loads, one of the most significant costs is low-cost energy. right? So once they know that you have a facility that accesses some of the lowest cost energy in the country, they're looking to site facilities around that. And so we're seeing the initial steps to something like that. It's hard for us though. It's you know, we're not the ones that are building the industrial plants. All we're hoping to do is build the highway, and then we'll develop exit ramps off of them. Okay.
One thing that really frustrates me about most politicians, Hayden excepted, of course, is that shouldn't have gone there. I'm flipping my train of thought now. They don't explain simple economics. A lot of people are too busy making a living to really study the market forces, et cetera. So, and the one example that I like to give people is with regard to solar panels. You know, the only people that can afford to put solar panels on their houses are people that are rather well off, and they don't really need the subsidies, but you know, they're available to them. And who picks up the tab for those subsidies? The average person. So as far as the PennEast pipeline, do you have some, and because most of us really are introverts, and the Tea Party is probably no different there. So we tend to not, or I sometimes hesitate to go and try to argue, even though I like to do that. But so are there any like elevator speeches that you could give us as an example of something that we could introduce into the conversation that would help us convince our neighbors? And does it do any good to talk to the general public, because basically this is going to be a FERC decision and it really doesn't matter what the outspoken antagonists or what we protagonists care?
Yeah, I can tell you, selfishly, that we would love to have a little bit of help telling FERC that there are people out there that do care, want to see lower cost energy, that recognize that you can develop infrastructure and do it in a safe way with minimal impacts. So yeah, we would love to have support. I mean, and there's that can only help us, and that can only help expedite the process. I mean, to the gentleman's question, and I apologize, I couldn't answer it, but one of the things that FERC, I'm sure, would weigh in their decision is if there is a significant amount of people that are supporting a project as opposed to the ones that are vocally opposed to it, it changes sort of their view of how quickly that process needs to move forward. If it looks like everyone in the world is opposed to something, I think they're going to take their time, make sure that they dot their I's and cross their T's. I think they should do that anyways. But so support is always helpful. There's no question about that. In terms of an elevator speech, again, the way I always sum it up is, again, we're talking about a project that is, again, going to reduce costs significantly to consumers. It's going to provide an economic benefit. It's going to lead to additional economic development. And again, we're going to do it in a responsible way, because these are entities that have significant stakes in these communities to begin with. So, that's really it. I mean, that's what we're focused on. So, that short message to me should resonate with a lot of people. But.
You've done a good job in explaining the benefits of the pipeline, and I am in favor of it, but I always tend to look at things from a little different angle.
Sure.
And you alluded to the answer to my question when you were answering Hayden's question here, but what's in it for UGI? What's in it for the company? Where are your profits? Where are your benefits coming from?
Sure. So
I mean, I'm sure it's not just feeling good that you've lowered the cost for the consumer.
No, we don't spend $1 billion, for free. It's
so I'm looking
sure
for that benefit. The potential of new business. I understand that, but I'm seeing that as so far down the line.
Yeah.
Really looking for what are the company's real motivation? Where do they really benefit?
Yeah. So it's like anything else. We make an investment. We expect to earn a return on that. So when we, as pipeline developers, as we build make the investment, we go out, we contract. I was showing one of my earlier slides the folks that actually contract for this, which are utilities and marketers and things like that. That 1 billion cubic feet of contracts of folks signing up saying we want a space in that PennEast pipeline, they're paying us for that space. So UGI gets a return on our investment through the contracts that we have with those folks. But again, what's important is we're able to earn our return and do it at a rate, though, that we assess to those utilities that still provides a benefit to these local areas, because in those economics that I'm showing you, the savings to the consumer, that includes the cost of us building this and assessing that cost to these local utilities. So yes, we absolutely earn a return. We're a for-profit business. I don't hide that in any way. But you can't do that to public utilities because of the regulations over public. You can't say, hey, I'm going to charge you whatever the heck I want, because guess what? There's a bunch of state regulators that are looking, saying, did you make a prudent decision when you did that? I don't know if it's helpful, but we talked a little bit at dinner about the utility model. So when it comes to purchasing commodity for consumers and purchasing pipeline capacity, local utilities are not allowed to make a profit on that. So UGI Utilities has to take the cost. It pays Penn East or Transco or Columbia or whoever the interstate pipeline is, the cost that they actually buy the gas from the producers up in the Marcellus, that cost has to get passed on dollar for dollar with no markup to you as the consumer. There's a timing issue, they change it every 4 months, but ultimately they have to prove that they're not charging you anything for that. What they're making the money on is the fact that you're using their pipes to move that volume, and then they get a distribution charge, okay? So we can't simply just come in here with a cost of a pipeline project and say, hey, pay us anything and we'll build this. We actually have to show that the economics, the savings that we offer by building this project, because we're giving you access to the lowest cost resource in the country, that still makes more sense than other alternatives out there, okay?
Yeah, hi, Kevin. Thanks for all the information.
Sure.
You're doing a great job. I tried to contact FERC, and they're asking for a docket number.
Yes.
You have a number?
Yeah, I'm sorry. It's PF15-1. I'm sorry, that should also be on their website. If it's not, I apologize.
It probably is, but I wrote in this stuff, and then it's asking for a docket number.
Yeah, our docket number is, it's P as in Peter, F as in Frank, 15-1-000. Sorry, it's a government numbering system, I'm sure.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sure, thank you.
There was one last question that I was actually asked to ask you.
Okay.
What are the diameters of the pipeline and the specifics? So how long, how wide, what's the actual pipe, what is it?
It's a 36 inch outer diameter. The wall thickness, we're still engineering, but I can tell you that at a minimum, it'll be at least 0.6 inches thick wall thickness. 0.63 is the minimum it can be. It'll more than likely be larger than that. 114 miles. What else can I tell you about the technical details of the pipeline? There's a compressor station. The compressor station is located in Carbon County. There's about 32,000 horsepower of engines that we'll have providing the horsepower. I'm not sure what other technical details I can offer, but certainly happy to answer more questions.
What pressure will it be at?
So the maximum, what we call our MAOP, the maximum allowable operating pressure, so that's the highest we'll ever operate at, is it'll be rated for 1,480 pounds. Now again, when we test the pipeline, we put it under a test, we'll test to over 150% of that, but that's the maximum we'll ever operate at. But the way that the pipelines work is, we'll operate or kind of float around what we need to ensure that the gas can get delivered to the other pipes we interconnect with. So it may not actually operate at 1480, but that's the maximum it will operate at.
Would you please estimate a timeline for this project? I don't have a long time to wait.
But we hope to have it in service. If we can move things along, we hope to have it in service by the winter of 2017. So, hang in there.
Can you tell me what percentage of that you know that you have customers for now, and then which will.
So out of that billion cubic feet, we have 990,000 a day subscribed, so that's like 99% subscribed. So, does that answer your question?
Well,
that means there's no other, you're using pretty much the max that you've got, so if there's any peripheral businesses that build up, there won't be any capacity.
Yeah, so it depends. So some of the companies buy capacity. It depends, and again, not to belabor the point, but there it depends. So some utilities buy capacity in anticipation of growth, and so what they're able to do is they have to sort of forecast out, because we're talking about a three-year development process. So they may have space. There's a whole process in the FERC world where if you're not using capacity, even though you subscribed it, you can release it to others. A lot of power generators actually rely on released capacity that utilities aren't using during certain times of the year. And so all that kind of gets factored in, and the market sort of dictates the size of the project that we build, and that's why we go out for that open season and say, okay, who all wants to participate? Tell us what you want. Because ultimately, if we're building a lot of excess capacity and it doesn't get filled, that's, you know, it's being borne by someone, you know, and so we try to right size the project to begin with, but there's typically room for growth, or either, again, because all the capacity won't be utilized from day one, or, you know, again, there are other conditions that may allow us to expand the capacity as well.
What type of terrorist attack provisions have you caught against terrorist attacks? You know what I'm saying? Do you have anything implemented against terrorist attacks?
Yeah, so the one thing to remind folks is the 99% of this pipeline is underground. Okay, and so the terrorists would have to spend a lot of time digging up, you know, the pipe, and people would have to be ignoring someone digging up our pipeline. But we have remotely actuated valves along the pipeline. So to the extent that someone tried to do something, or if someone wasn't even trying to do something, if there was some type of anomaly or an issue on the pipeline, we'd have the ability to remotely shut off, the pipeline, the volume of the gas. And again, we're continuously monitoring. I mean, part of the safety aspects of operating a pipeline of this size and scale is we're continuously monitoring. We have a gas control center in Reading, Pennsylvania that monitors the temperature, the pressure, the volume on a 24-hour basis. We have alarms built in that are actually looking for those things and saying, hey, if something changes, and it changes over this kind of amount of time, signal to someone that they need to go look at it. And so we have continuous monitoring, and that's all year long. But we also have the ability to shut the system down if necessary under a condition like that.
Are there any other questions? Okay, thank you very much,
okay,
Kevin.
Thank you.
Round of applause. I didn't prepare any jokes, so you're just going to have to laugh at me. We have a couple upcoming events. You may have seen them. You may have heard about them. How many of you are going on the Gettysburg trip with us? Good. August 1st. Mary Ellen's going to send out the information. If you have any questions, don't wait for us. We're going to meet at the William Penn Park and Ride. The bus leaves at 7 o'clock. Don't be late. The Oliver North event. Who's going to see Oliver North? How many of you are going to join us for dinner? How many of you would like to join us for dinner but haven't yet purchased your dinner tickets? Anybody? Okay. Do you know where to find the information? Okay. We're offering seats at the tea party tables in the dinner for $200 per person. That includes the dinner, a meet and greet with Colonel North, an opportunity for a photograph, an orchestra seat for the speaking event, and dinner. So if you're interested and you'd like to go to the dinner portion, that's the sponsorship, that's what's mostly going to help pay for this, come and see Mary Ellen or Andrew Azan in the back or Tony Simeo or me. We'll get those reservations in as quick as we can, and then you'll have a week or two to send in the check. Yes? There's also a special package for Bring a Veteran. We called it Bring a Veteran. Those seats are $150 for two. They are only for the speaking event. Those are front balcony, they're called. They're about stage level,
and they're the most forward seats on the right and left side of the stage. So we made sure that we reserved the best eye level seats and the closest and the side sections for our veterans. So if you'd like to bring a veteran or you know somebody you'd like to honor, you can buy two tickets, one for you and one for them, and bring them along. Or if you know two veterans, like my parents, you can buy two tickets and just give it to them and invite them and tell them to come along. Are there any questions about the Oliver North event? Now Mary Ellen's gonna come up and tell you about an exciting opportunity we have right now. How many of you have $10 in your pocket? How many of you have it but don't want to tell me? How many of you are tired of me asking for money? Go ahead, Maria.
Okay, we are offering two VIP seats for the dinner meet and greet with Colonel North, and of course, orchestra seats for his speaking engagement. A pair for $10 is your chance. So see me afterwards if you're interested. Thank you.
If you're interested, raise your hand. Mary Ellen will come around to you. Valerie in the back. Anybody up front? Joy Hemming, right up in the front here. This gentleman with the maroon shirt. Bob Kernicki's interested. Okay, put your hands up nice and high. Somebody take a look around. If you want to take a chance, if you'd like a chance that Mary Ellen has, raise your hand. She'll come around. The July 4th reading of the Declaration, I have on my notes to make the announcement, but I'm going to scratch that off for obvious reasons.
One for next year.
It's early notice for next year. Thank you, Hayden. How many of you went to that? If you didn't go, you really missed it. If you enjoyed it, clap. Every year it gets better. There's more participation. It's non-political. Everyone has a good time. And it sounds like they're reading about the current administration. The AFP Ohio trip. Brian, are you here?
Yes.
Okay.
Can I have a couple seconds?
Yeah.
Checking agenda.
Ronnie, you get the lights.
After victory on the national scale, and AFP is front and center leading that fight.
The people, the dedicated volunteers and patriots of the Americans for Prosperity, because of you, I know our nation will be more prosperous. Because of you, I know our nation will be more free.
Years ago, Americans for Prosperity, we had 14 state chapters and about a million grassroots activists on the team. Today, we have over 500 staff in 33 states and 2.3 million Americans in our cause with us.
Without our members, Americans for Prosperity is an organization without a heartbeat.
The summit has been so educational and inspirational. I'm not just getting rejuvenated and excited for the elections, I'm learning things that I take home to my business that I can apply.
People from all over the country are here today, united in our defense of freedom, prosperity, and liberty.
The American dream is alive and is continuing to march forward and giving people hope that we can save America.
It's really interesting and there's a lot of good speakers.
I love the panels, but I also love the networking. You get a whole bunch of really great, smart, conservative people all in one place, and then you can just go talk to them. It's so fun.
My hands were sore at the end because I clapped so much. You know, we gave several standing ovations just spontaneously because it's such great content.
Enthusiasm to win in this fight for freedom. We need you engaged in helping to preserve the American dream. We need you as a community organizer, conservative style. Are you with me?
I am never going to apologize for fighting to preserve and protect the American dream for my children and my children's children.
That's how it's done in the free market.
This is our country.
Let's restore its dreams. Let's chart its new destiny. Let's make it worthy of all those who have sacrificed and all those who are to come. God bless you, and God bless America.
Ted Cruz, Rick Perry,
Marco Rubio,
and Jeb Bush. We'll be speaking. We do have I'm blanking my mind. Scott Walker has not confirmed, nor has Rand Paul, but they are invited. So I think they're probably going to come. This was the one that was in Dallas last year. There were 3,000 people. If they can get 3,000 people from Pennsylvania and Ohio to speak to, I can't see any of the presidential candidates not making time to come. It's going to be a great time. AFP is really helping us out here. They know it's a big commitment to leave on a Thursday, drive all the way out to Ohio, stay for 2 days, and then drive all the way back. So they know that it's a big commitment for us to go to this. It's going to be an awesome event. They are only charging us $25 per person, double occupancy. So that means if you get somebody to stay with you and contact me, I'm coordinating people if they need a roommate. This is going to be a great event. I know we're a little light this month. Talk to your friends that are in the Tea Party. Let's get some folks out to this. I really thought we could fill a bus. We got about 8 people so far. So I don't know what to say. I mean, it can't get any cheaper, and it's really going to be a fun event. I really hope we can get some more people out. It's going to be disappointing to tell them that we could only get 8 or 10, 12 people to go out to this event when they're helping us out so much. They're still going to do it. It's not, you know, they're going to, you know, we'll be grouped with other people that are coming out of Pennsylvania. But really would love to see if we could fill a bus up for them. So talk to your friends. They don't have to be a Tea Party member per se. Obviously, they should be conservative. I think they wouldn't enjoy it very much if they didn't. But I was handing these out. I'm going to have them in the back again. I didn't put them out on all the tables. There's two ways you can sign up. You can send me the check made out to AFP with your roommate and the information. You can also sign up on the website. It's very easy. It's lvtp.org/AFP, Americans for Prosperity. You go to that, it'll have the information, you'll hook directly to them, and you'll be signing up. Do not, at the bottom of the flyer, it says defendingtheamericandream.com. Don't go to that to sign up, because that's just the regular guys. Right now it's $75 just to register for the event. Just for the event. That's not a hotel or a bus or anything. So they are really helping us out. I'd really like to see the LVTP have a good showing at this. So please find the time to come out to this event. It's really going to be exciting. It's July 20th is when we're leaving. And then
August.
August 20th when we're leaving. The 21st and the 22nd are the event, and we'll get back probably sometime late Sunday or early Sunday morning. Should I just go right into the pig roast? The weekend before is our pig roast, the 15th. Really love, that's a lot of fun. I'd love to see more kids at this event. This park is great. Bring your grandkids, bring your kids. It's a lot of fun. The food is great. I believe we got Ben is going to be cooking again on the grill. So again, Ben and his wife, I forgot. Ben Hendricks, yeah. And Marcy. We're going to be cooking on the grill.
And then we got Mike with the pig, and really an awesome event. You can see me after the meeting to buy tickets. It's $25 a head and $45 a couple. I have some of these color brochures of this. Take, if you want, take one of these, stick it up in your local grocery store or wherever there's things. Contact us. Let's get some other people involved. It's clearly the Lehigh Valley Tea Party. We're not shy about it, but maybe we can get some more people involved in the group. And it's a great way for people to meet us and find out about us. So if you want, put your hand up if you want one of these to put out at your local constabularies. All right? Thank you very much.
Next month is the next meeting. It's the last time you can sign up for this.
Just a few more things and we're going to wrap it up. Community Days. How many of you helped out at the Cement and Fair? Raise your hand. Thank you very much. Glenn, do you have a report on how we did at Community Days in Cementon? Okay, we covered our cost. That's a good thing. And people signed up to get our emails, right? Two sheets of people. Folks, if you don't think Community Days make a difference, you have to come out and help out. Our next one is July 18th. It's Nazareth Day. It's going to be in the Nazareth Park. I'll be out there all day. If you're a Second Amendment guy or gal, wear your firearm. It opens up great conversation. It's a fantastic way to reach the community, talk to them about safety, our other issues. Right now, who's ever heard of Donald Trump? Anybody? What issue has he raised and brought to the forefront?
Selling
ties, Tony says. Illegal immigration. Illegal immigration is not going away anytime soon. This is a great opportunity to talk about illegal immigration. If you're on that committee, or if you want to join that committee, or if you just want to talk about that issue, I'm sorry for making Hayden yawn. Come on out to Nazareth Day. It's going to be in the Borough Park. See Glenn to sign up, or just show up. You don't have to commit to a certain time if you can't. Also in August, how many of you remember hearing Simon Campbell when he was here last? Simon Campbell is a dynamic speaker. He's going to be here in August along with a special presentation from our Individual Rights Committee. If we lose our individual rights, none of the other ones matter. So see all the empty chairs next to you? August is Bring a Friend Month. If each one of you brings just one person, that means there'll be two of you. Please ask your kids, ask your neighbors, ask your coworkers, talk to them about taxes, illegal immigration, whatever the subject might be, something will pop up that you can make a connection and say, hey, you know what? Come with me next month in August. Bring a friend and let's see if we can't fill the room. All right, we're going to move into your time.
No.
Okay, we're not going to move into your time.
Uh-oh. Tom's time.
Oh boy.
She's selling things.
Okay, no, I'm not selling anything. Although I am, we are selling in the back an awesome KSG shotgun and a pocket revolver. I carry that same revolver.
I've got, Ronnie said I have about 30
cans. Can't hear you.
Ronnie said I have about 35 minutes. Oh, five. I thought it was 35. Sorry. Okay, I'll try to get through this in just 5 minutes. So, let's talk about public school policy for student strip search. How about that? Last month, Saucon Valley School District, while doing a rather routine policy update, almost passed a new policy that would have set the ground rules for conducting strip searches. In other words, they were telling administrators, what the guidelines would be for conducting strip searches of students. Well, what I can tell you is that we, the officers of the Lehigh Valley Tea Party, believe that school administrators should not be permitted at all to conduct strip searches of our children. And that if such a search is in fact necessary, it must be done by trained, uniformed police officers. Well, Brian Eichfeld, who happens to be a Saucon Valley school board member, made the case to the school board. There was a lot of work that went on behind the scenes, for sure. But he made the case for a no strip search policy. And they ultimately voted to enact that, thereby prohibiting school administrators from that activity. So, number one, thank you, Brian. The downside is that only Allentown, Salisbury, and Saucon Valley have such policies today here in the Lehigh Valley. In other words, all of the other school districts across the valley, it's okay for administrators to search your kids, your grandkids, strip search them. Well, this presents an opportunity for us to create some real change here. What we want to do is go to each school board and get them to enact the same policy as Saucon Valley. That means we're going to need to do letters. We're going to get out to these school board meetings. It means possibly distributing flyers around town to get the community involved in that effort. Tracking down board votes. There's going to be, you know, a first reading, a second reading, a vote. Then reporting all of this information back to a central point that we will set up. And reporting the final status. We also, as a part of this, have the opportunity to teach students that they have Fourth Amendment rights, that our Constitution is alive and well and protecting them every day. Right now, nobody's teaching them that. I suspect most students are completely unaware that they have a Fourth Amendment right that protects them against unreasonable search and seizure. So, in our view, this is an excellent way for us, the Tea Party, to get students, parents, grandparents, all involved in an issue that many are really very passionate about. But the Tea Party board can't do this all by ourselves. So, once again, we're looking for volunteers. What I'd like to know is, are you willing to help, even in some small way? It might be handing out flyers where we need them handed out. It might be making phone calls. It might be attending a school board meeting. Oftentimes these meetings require, in order to address the board, residents of that district are permitted to do so. And so we might need someone who lives in that particular district in order to address the board. Are you willing to play some role in this plan? And so, if you are, I'd ask that you please stand. Anyone. This gentleman, would you just shout out your name?
Mark.
Mark, and I need a last name.
McCarty.
McCarty, thank you. Bob Kronecki. Bill Tunkey, you're standing. Joe, are you standing for this? Glenn, are you standing for this? Thank you. In the back, Eric, are you standing for this? Either Valerie or Blair? Valerie, yes, and I'm working my way forward. Ginny Tabor. Ed, you're standing for this, Ed Beers. Eric, are you standing for this? Bill Antrim, thank you. Carla Hess. Ma'am, I'm sorry, I do not know your name. Kay, thank you. And by the way, if you're still standing and I've called your name, you can be seated. Thank you. And Cynthia, thank you. Are you seated? Are you?
I'm trying to stay awake so Ronnie doesn't call.
Okay, so that's it. We've got, thank you very much.
I'm standing, but I got
right. Oh, and Brian. Oh, this is all being recorded, so. Oh, Ronnie. Oh, yeah, I wasn't sure if you were sitting or standing. Stand up, Ronnie. Stand up, Ronnie. Oh, you are. Okay, thank you. We'll be in touch with you folks. And now, oh, and by the way, I'm very excited about this. I think we've got a real opportunity to get out there and get the parents, the grandparents, the kids, everybody involved in this. We certainly don't want to condone bad behavior by these kids. On the other hand, we want to make sure that they understand that before they can be searched, there are some levels that need to be reached. And when police are called, rather than school administrators, the police have to have probable cause rather than reasonable suspicion. So that bumps the requirement up, and that protects these kids far more than they are today. Thanks, this is now your time, and I'm gonna give the mic back to Ronnie.
One quick thing on that, I'm sorry, I was involved.
That's okay, wait for the microphone. Now it's your turn.
Oh, I don't have it.
You need the microphone. I'll start off with what I found out with this, I never realized I was going to become a strip search expert, but somehow things pop up when you're on a school board. And as Tom indicated, policies are written in school boards for different things. There's no policy. If there's no policy on it, that doesn't mean it can't be done. What happened is back in the Supreme Court, the Supreme Court basically gave guidance as to the severity of how an administrator can be allowed to do a strip search. So what happens is if the policy's silent, it means that they can do it because the laws say they can do it. So that's what the concern is. The big concern here is when you go, and I don't know how, so when you go to these school boards, they're going to say, oh, well, we don't do strip searches as students. I've been on the boards. I know this is going to be their response. But the fact is, when their policies are silent on this, you can't have a policy on everything out there. You know, it's impossible. So then you follow the regular law. So that's what needs to be put forward to these folks so that they understand, oh, well, we don't do strip search in our policy. Yeah, but the law says you can, so you need to change your policy. Anyone else? Comments or questions? This is your time. In the back, Glenn. Wait for the microphone. I'm a full 5'4", in case you're wondering about that short joke Tom told.
Ronnie, you were wondering about our last community days at Cement Fair. I think the table cost like $110, and I added them up. We received $207 in donations. So we did pretty well, and that's considering the final day was rained out completely. And then one other thing about community days is that, you know, when you get two, three people helping, a lot of times they've never really talked together before, and they get to be closer, become better friends because they're spending some time together at the table. So that's just another benefit of helping out at community days. That's all I wanted to say.
Anyone else? Up here in the blue hat.
Did you know that Bobby Gunther Walsh had a guy there that is involved with the Sanctuary City stuff and stuff like that? And he said that Lehigh County, Easton, and Allentown are sanctuary cities, and Lehigh County itself is a sanctuary county.
Does everyone understand what he's talking about, a sanctuary city? These are cities where the legislature has decided they're not going to pursue action against illegal immigrants. So they're basically announcing to illegal immigrants, come to our city and you'll be protected. The gentleman who just killed the woman in California?
Yeah, San Francisco.
He was prosecuted, I think, 5 times for deportation. It wasn't an actual deportation because, you know, our government's efficiency. They just never got to it. But 5 times it came up for him to be deported, and he still wasn't. That's a sanctuary city. Sal Panto in Easton, Ed Pulowski in Allentown, and Bethlehem is... Who's the mayor of Bethlehem?
Donchess.
Bethlehem is not. I stand corrected. So is Allentown, Easton, and what other town?
Lehigh County.
Any other comments? Are there? Hayden.
I follow a lot of politics. I didn't know Easton was a sanctuary city. I do know that recently Easton, the mayor, and the city council passed a resolution encouraging that illegal immigrants get driver's license, even, I believe, commercial driver's license. So, but to your point is, I don't know if they're labeled as a sanctuary city, but I was very concerned. John Morganelli, who's spoken to us here, the DA, is livid. He made a direct connection between commercial driver's license, illegal immigration, and the threat to national security. Very powerful, but they don't listen to him. But to your point, I don't know if Easton is a sanctuary city, but it's really close if it's not.
Anyone else? Any other questions or comments? You're all quiet tonight. We still have 25 minutes. Well, if there are no other questions or comments, please see Mary Ellen or Tony or me if you'd like tickets or a chance to win tickets for Oliver North. That's going to be, if you'd like to sponsor a table, if you know a business or have a business and would like to sponsor a table, the sponsorship comes with some special perks. Let us know about that also. The event is going to be at the Sands Event Center. The arena itself holds 2,000 people, just about. There's going to be a book signing afterwards. We're going to have some special things happen before the event. And at the dinner, you'll have an opportunity to meet Colonel North himself. So if you'd like a flyer for your business, or you know someone who might be interested, if you can't sponsor a whole table, but you'd like to put a message in there and honor a veteran or honor a current service member, we have some small sponsorships for the playbill. Those are available. Please see Bob in the back for your gun raffle tickets. And with that, I'll entertain. We only have 20 minutes, Tom.
I know I'm a lawyer. I speak too much. Stan's not here to yell at me to shut up. Just wanted to say I know that with the events of the last several weeks, with the Supreme Court decisions and other things that are happening in the world, many of us, including myself, are, among other things, angry, depressed, ready to give up sometimes. We can't do that. We have to keep plugging away, and we have to keep understanding that it is the right thing to do. We were given our life and our liberty from God. And God is on our side, and we have to be on God's side. So just keep the faith and keep remembering that this is not just about us individually. This is about our families, our neighborhoods, our communities, and it is the right thing to do. So God bless all of you, and thank you for coming out, and keep up the fight. Keep active, because we cannot give up, and we need to keep talking to our neighbors, our friends, our family. So God bless you, and have a good night.
I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Motion by Bill Tunkey. Is there a second? Oh, I'm sorry. Carla?
What?
Sure, hold on.
I just wanted to mention to all of you that the Senate is considering Senate Bill 1177. It's about the reauthorization of the Elementary Secondary Education Act.
Did it pass?
Are you serious?
Yeah.
And the House just passed last week. They just passed H.R. 5, which is their version. Now what's going to happen is the two are going to be put together. Please contact Toomey and Casey and Dent. and keep after them and tell them you are very disappointed and that you do not appreciate this being passed. It really is dangerous for our kids and for our whole education system. It is not anything positive. It is making Common Core worse. They're taking over more of your parenting and giving it to the school and to psychologists and psychiatrists and even teachers who are going to be psychologically evaluating your kids. So I just ask all of you to please call them, even if they've passed it. This isn't finalized yet. So just call them and let them know where you're coming from. Thank you.
Unless your name is Allison Del Baco, then they're going to pretty much leave you alone. Okay, we have a motion from Bill Tunkey. May I have a second? Tom Campione, thank you. We're adjourned. I'll see you folks in August with one friend. Have a good night. Thank you.